As Grant said, talk about what it takes to unlock the highest levels of performance in organisations and teams by really understanding what motivates people and what makes them tick. I'm going to jump straight in. I'm going to share with you a piece of research that connects individuals to performance. Hands up here who's got kids. Hands up here who was once a kid. Okay, pretty much everybody, so we know what kids are like. Hands up here who's ever tried to bribe a kid to do something. Yeah, pretty much, I've got a three-year-old, and I'm realising that that is the only way that he is going to eat is by me literally bribing him. So I'm going to share with you a piece of research that is all about toddlers and performance, and specifically, can you get toddlers to become more helpful? Okay. The way this experiment sets up is in the corner of the room there's a researcher sitting behind a table. The researcher is occasionally is fiddling with some paper, will occasionally drop some paper off the table. In the middle of the room is a small toddler playing with an amazing toy. So this toy is bright lights going off and noises, so it's a high distraction toy. For a three-year-old it's absolutely amazing. The experiment asks, when the researcher drops paper off the table, will the toddler leave this amazing toy and go and help the researcher? Okay? So hands up here if you think that less than 50% of the time the toddler will help the researcher. Less than 50% of the time. Okay, the child haters in the room, got you. The rest of the child, okay, the optimists. Okay, so here's what happens. So you can see the video, the researcher top left, the toddler in the middle. Here's how it plays out. Drops the paper, toddler gets up. Goes and helps the researcher. Adorable. It turns out that over 90% of the time in this experiment, the toddler got up and help the researcher. My kid, definitely in the 10%, but over 90%, and this experiment's replicated across the country, so it's pretty reliable findings. This experiment wasn't actually about that though, it was about whether or not you can improve the performance of a toddler by measuring helpfulness in this case. There are three groups. There is the control group, where they just do this time and time again and see how the performance is affected. The second group is the praise group, where every time the toddler does gets up and helps the researcher, a little, oh, well done, nice one. And then the third group is the electric shock group, where, I'm kidding, I'm sure you're awake. Third group is the reward group. So the kid stands up, goes and helps the researcher, and they're given a little treat as a reward. And the experiment looks at how that affects performance. So here's what happens. The control group slightly decreases over time. Kids get a little bit tired, and therefore goes down to 89%. The praise group drops down to 81%. So actually, by saying well done, the performance of the toddler decreases, the reward group plummets down to 53%. So by the end of the day, if you keep saying to a toddler either well done, or even worse, giving them a little treat, their performance actually halves. Just for fun, I'm gonna show you a toddler in the reward group that was helpful at the beginning of the day. This is what they look like at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Stares at the researcher. Goes on for quite a long time. Nothing. Again, this toddler has been rewarded. This kid now works in the DMV. So why have I showed you that? Well, what this experiment, and by the way, thousands of other experiments like it, tell us is that our traditional forms of affecting behaviour and motivating people to do stuff are actually perhaps not as valuable and valid as we might think. Most of our strategies for getting people to do stuff at work are built fundamentally on a praise and reward system. Most of our ways of getting kids to learn at school are based on praise and reward. this experiment, thousands of others like it, start to question that and start to actually ask us the question, well, what does performance really mean? How do we motivate people to have the highest levels of performance? And how do we create the right conditions in organizations for our kids to really unlock them? And so I'm going to try to unpick that question a bit today in the next kind of 40, 45 minutes. I'm going to answer three questions. One is, what is performance? I'm going to go beyond just traditional business results. Second thing I'll answer is, what drives performance? What is the psychology that actually causes people to do stuff, to do anything, including learning? And the third thing is, what is culture? Which is all about how you create the conditions to unlock motivation and ultimately drive performance. So I'm going to tell you a few stories today to bring this to life. Are there any French people in the room? Fantastic. This is a story about an English victory over the... Any English in the room? Awesome. Great. So this is going to be... You're going to love this. So this is a story set in the early 1800s. It's a story of the Battle of Trafalgar. And at this time, Napoleon is the French commander, and he set his sights on conquering Europe. In 1810, everything in colour is Napoleon and the French's territory. So they set their eyes on the beautiful United Kingdom in the top left and say, right, we want to conquer the UK. Napoleon has the dominant army of the day. Can anybody tell me what Nelson, the commander of the British, has? The Navy fleet. Yeah, we've got the dominant Navy of the day. And while we have the dominant Navy of the day, Napoleon can't land the army on the United Kingdom and conquer the British. And the reason that that's important is because the way naval warfare works, or worked in those days at least, is you would have two opposing fleets float up alongside each other in parallel lines. They would aim their cannons at each other, would fire until one side either surrendered or kind of ran off in retreat. And it sounds like a very silly way to fight, but there's pretty good reasons for it. One is it allows you to concentrate your cannon, and the second reason has to do with communication. So obviously there's no radios or any other way of communicating other than flags. So by organizing your ships in parallel lines, you could have a flagship which everybody could see. The commander would issue flag commands. That way of fighting means that if you are outnumbered in boats or ships, probably is the right term, you are guaranteed to lose. So you have less ships, you're going to lose. That's why the British were able to defend themselves. So what does Napoleon decide to do? He combines the French and the Spanish fleets to create a super armada that outnumbers and outguns the British, and that is the story of the Battle of Trafalgar. So here's how it works. The British have 33 ships, 2,318 cannons. French and Spanish, 21% more ships, 24% more cannons. So they are guaranteed to win in history. They are 100% guaranteed to win. Not only is this a disaster for the British, we're going to be, you know, dominated, but we're also going to be conquered by the French. Which, if you're English, is really a disaster. So this is really bad news. Nelson, the commander, is scratching his head. What is he going to do? Because he knows he's going to lose. So what he decides to do is something quite radical. He develops a plan which has two parts to it. The first part of the plan is, he says, look, instead of floating up into parallel lines, we're going to attack in a perpendicular line straight for the enemy. Now, that's high risk, because when you're attacking, you're taking on enemy fire that you can't return. High risk, high risk strategy, but that's part one. Part two is, he says to his commanders, he said, listen, once we attack, we're going to try to take out the enemy flagship, we're going to try to cut off the head, but then I don't know what's going to happen. We're going to create as much chaos and confusion as we possibly can. I want you to not to look to me for commands. I'm not going to give any. I'm not going to issue any flag commands. I trust you to adapt in the context that you're in, engage the nearest ships, and do whatever you can. So every night he takes his commanders into his cabin, he goes through it every night so they really understand the two parts of this plan. The day of the battle comes. The British fleet attack in two parallel lines, but in a perpendicular way. They take out the enemy flagship within the first 2 minutes. Nelson, the British commander, loses his life within the first 10 minutes. So it's a good thing that his people aren't looking to him for commands, because he's literally unable to give them. Create huge confusion. The French and Spanish are frozen. They're looking for commands that aren't coming, and therefore they don't know what to do. The British are ready. They know they can adapt. They win. By the time the smoke has cleared, 26 out of 40 French and Spanish ships are lost without the loss of a single British ship. And it is a story of one of the most lopsided naval victories in history that should have been an original loss. And the reason we know so much about it is because it started to challenge some of the basic assumptions about what it makes the difference between winning or losing. What it tells us is there are two different opposing forces or opposing types of performance that you need to get right. The first is tactical performance. This is the plan. We're going to attack in two perpendicular lines. That's what we're going to do. The second piece, though, is adaptive performance. Adaptive performance is what happens when the conditions change, when you need to adapt to the context, or when a problem happens, or you need to problem solve. What Nelson realized is that we have a great tactical plan, we're going to create chaos, therefore need adaptive performance. The French and Spanish weren't ready. And the reason we like to start when we think about culture here is that most executives, most organizations, really only fully understand tactical performance. You're taught how to develop a strategy, how to develop a plan, how to put that into place. But not many organizations, not many executives really understand the balancing that you need to do with adaptive performance. Why this is important is if you have too much tactical, you eat your adaptive performance. Equally, if you have too much adaptive performance, you end up being very chaotic and it kills your ability to be tactical. So startups, high growth, young startups tend to be very, very adaptive, but unable to scale easily because they're not very, haven't got their tactical performance down. Massive corporations tend to be great at tactical performance, but it's hard for them to be adaptive performance. So these two things need to be kept in check. So that's kind of part one of our talk, the importance of keeping both of these things together. Second thing is what drives performance. We've done a lot of research around this. We've read every book, we've read all of the research around what drives performance. And we've come up with one really, really simple insight, which is this. Why we work determines how well we work. Put differently, if you can really unlock somebody's underlying motivation, then you'll have a much greater likelihood of getting them to be able to not just do tactical performance, check the boxes, but actually really lean into their performance and try to improve it. If you can unlock the why for somebody. And we've developed a really simple framework that explains why pretty much anybody does anything. And I'm just going to bring it to life for you now. There's three parts to this. We call it the motive spectrum. First part is the work itself. Are you motivated by the act of actually doing the job in front of you and the tasks that involves? Second piece is your identity. Are you motivated because of you to do something because you think it's important because of what you value and who you are? And then the third piece is external forces. Are you motivated by things happening around you, your organization or the people around you? And we've identified six points across this spectrum that really make the biggest difference. The first is play. Play is when you enjoy doing something because you just enjoy the act of doing it. So for those of you who have a hobby, you're doing that because you have high play for that, not because you're forced to do it, not because you're paid to do it, just because you enjoy the actual act of it. That is different to fun. A lot of people think this is about fun, it's not. It's about the actual getting in flow of doing something. Second thing is purpose. Purpose is when you do something because you value the outcome of it. So it's connected to the work, but it's also connected to what you think is important. And then the final one of the first three is potential. Potential is when you do something because you feel like you're progressing or you're getting somewhere as a result of it, you're learning. So to bring these to life, we call these direct motives because they connect to the work itself. My brother is a very motivated teacher. He's a teacher in the UK. And when I ask him why, he says, one, I really love being in a classroom. I enjoy the actual act of teaching kids. I feel like time stops still, high play. He says, I really value education. I love feeling like I'm doing something important for society, high purpose. And he says, I want to be a head teacher. So actually getting lots of hours in the classroom is going to really help me there. That's a motivator. So these three direct motives you want to maximize. The more your direct motives, you have direct motives, the more able you are to not just be tactical in your performance, but actually really lean into the adaptive side of it. There are other reasons for doing stuff that we call indirect, because they don't connect to the work itself. Has anybody here ever tried to guilt a loved one into doing something? Yes. I'm going to assume everybody is a yes. My wife is a master at this. My mum is even better, because she knows me. Yeah, and so she can, able to get me something because she knows what I value. She knows everything about me. So these are indirect motives. The indirect motive that I've just talked about is emotional pressure. I can guilt somebody into doing something. I can scare somebody into doing something. That's emotional pressure. But actually, although it might get them to do that type of thing, it's going to get them really to check the box, to just do what I want them to do, as opposed to really being motivated to improve the performance. But it is a way to get somebody to doing something. Second one is economic pressure. Economic pressure is when you do something for a reward or to avoid a punishment. And if this is used wrongly, as a good example, it can really kill adaptive performance. If you think of a sales force, or people have incredibly high pressure sales environments, that would be an example of very, very high economic pressure that may cause people to do the wrong thing. You've seen the Wells Fargo news over the last year or so, when you see thousands of people creating millions of fake accounts, it's as a direct result of the incredible economic pressure that's put on them. Therefore, they're doubling down on tactical performance. I just need to create new accounts and not thinking about what the right thing to do is. Economic pressure. Then the final one is inertia. Inertia is when you ask somebody to do something, or you ask somebody why they're doing something, and they look at you blankly and say, I don't really know, I'm just doing it, because I've always been doing it. This is the biggest killer of adaptive performance. It's far away from the work itself. We see it a lot in business. You see a lot of people in teams and you're saying that person's just checking the boxes, or they're just doing what they've done because they're just doing it. So our research has basically boiled down this concept into a really simple kind of metric that we call TOMO, or total motivation. Basically, our research has shown that if you maximize the direct motives and minimize the indirect motives, your company, your team, your individual will perform better. So just to bring this to life with a few quick stories. So I want you to think of a relationship that you've been in at some point. Could be with a colleague, could be with a loved one, could be now, could be in the past. And I want you to ask yourself, you're not going to share this, why are you in that relationship? Or why were you in that relationship? Now when we do this, we find some people say, oh, I just enjoy being with that person. We have a real laugh together. That would be play. Some people say, we're in this because we're building something important. We've got a family, you know, we're building a business. That would be purpose. Or you might say something like, when I'm with that person, they bring out the best in me. They make me a better person. That would be potential. Or you might be looking at me and saying, well, I'm slightly scared of leaving them. They'll be really cross with me if I do. Emotional pressure. We've got a massive mortgage. We need double salary in order to maintain our Hamptons beach house. Mm-hmm. Or you might even worse be looking at me and saying, thanks very much for bringing this up on a Thursday afternoon, Simon. I don't really know. That is for you and you only. But imagine a relationship driven by play, purpose, and potential. And imagine a relationship driven by the indirect motives. You might imagine a different result. The research shows this to be the case. Strong positive correlation across hundreds of studies showing a strong positive correlation between paid purpose and potential and marital happiness. Strong negative correlation between the indirect motives and marital happiness. We see the same thing playing out with schools and high school achievement. Imagine a kid that loves, I was a very good geography student. I love geography, my teacher made it fun. My teacher explained why geography was important when I walk around the world, I can encode everything, and he gave me great feedback and coaching. So I was very, very well motivated. I did quite well. Imagine a kid who's bribed to do their homework, they're guilted into studying something, and they're just studying a topic because it's on the curriculum. High indirect motives, you see a direct relationship with performance. We see this in athletic grit, we see this in employee engagement. So reliable is this finding, we boiled it down into something that we call total motivation. Total motivation is a metric. What we're trying to do is high TOMO, we're trying to maximize play, purpose, and potential and minimize our indirect motives. If you've ever been on a team or in a business where you were just, or a job where you were flying, you were loving it, Sunday night, you couldn't wait for Monday to start. You got to Friday, you wanted the week to continue. You were thinking about it all the time because you loved it. That's because you are having a high TOMO scenario. If you've ever been in a situation where you get to Sunday night, the worst thing you can think of is, I'm going to get up in the morning and go to my job. That's because you're doing it for the wrong reasons. Lack of play, lack of purpose, lack of potential. So hopefully that makes sense so far. It's a pretty simple concept, but it's a pretty reliable predictor of performance. So I'm going to play a quick game. What I'm going to do in a second is I'm going to share with you a grid of 12 numbers, okay? And I'm going to ask you to find the two numbers in that grid that add up to 10. It's a bit of fun. I'm a bit of a math. I love puzzles, Sudokus, stuff like that. So we're just going to have a bit of fun with this. When you've solved it, no big deal, sit in your chair. Just give me a quick wave or a little nod so I know that you've done it, so I can just get a read of the room. But this is a no-pressure scenario, just for fun. Everybody ready? Okay. Yeah, a couple of people. Okay. Yeah, a few people, so give it a nod. Okay, most people. Okay, great. Can somebody tell me which of the two numbers?
Bottom left, bottom right.
Bottom left, bottom right. Excellent, good stuff. Okay, so pretty easy, quite good fun. We're now going to do that again. Except this time, I'm going to ask this table to stand up. Okay, if you guys can stand up, all of you. You look like you're a pretty smart table. I looked at you and I thought they're intelligent, they got it really quickly. So we're going to do it again, and I'm going to give you another grid, same set of same 12 numbers, but different numbers on it. So the solution is different, but you're still looking to find the two numbers that add up to 10, if that makes sense. When you've done it, you can sit down. Okay? And I'm going to come and ask you to whisper the solution into my ear. We get a lot of cheating at this point. For everybody else, you're gonna want to solve the puzzle. I don't want you to solve the puzzle. I want you to turn around your chairs. I want you to watch these group. And let's see who's the smartest. Okay? Or more importantly, let's see who the slowest is. Okay? So are you ready? Okay. Go. Okay, let's that's incorrect actually, yeah. Yeah, it's incorrect. So you stand back up. Make sure you've got your maths right. That's incorrect. Back up, yeah. That's correct. Back up. No, that's incorrect. Back up. Are you definitely sure you meant? No, that's bus. Sorry, back up. Okay, you get it. Okay, I'll put you up. Sit down, everybody sit down. Big round of applause, please, for our volunteers. I was going to call you volunteers then, obviously you're not. I apologise, first of all. I apologise for putting you through that. The correct answer? Yeah. Of course, everyone goes to the bottom left, bottom right every time. How was that for you guys? Is what I'm interested in. How was that experience for the people standing up?
Embarrassing.
Less than ideal.
Yeah, you're suddenly like, I just wanted to blend into the back and listen to a couple of speakers. What else? What's going through your head when I asked you to stand up?
Too much pressure.
A lot of pressure.
Panic.
Yeah. Hatred. Yeah, I mean, all of the above. And of course, that was deliberate. In the first example, I was trying to create very quickly a TOMO profile that was quite different to the second one. In the first one, I was trying to create a TOMO profile that looked a bit like this. I was trying to cue you for fun. This is easy. I hate Sudoku. I love puzzle, you know. I was trying to make it easy. Sit in your chairs, no big deal. Reducing the pressure. No reward, no punishment. No shame, no fear, all that kind of stuff. Trying to create a TOMO profile that looked like this. In the second one, I was trying to do something quite different. I was trying to make it less fun. I was trying to ramp up the pressure on it. So what kind of things was I saying to ramp up the pressure?
Everybody look there.
Yes, stand up, number one. Everybody stare at them. You can sit down. I was saying a lot of things like, you're really smart, you're really smart, let's see who's the slowest, let's see all that kind of stuff. And that has a direct ability, that drops your TOMO, That has a direct impact on your ability to perform. By the way, we find most groups when we do this, it's about 3 times slower to solve exactly the same problem. And just to make you guys feel better, this experiment was repeated with exactly the same cueing that I was doing there with MIT students, and they found with that it was a 32% drop in performance. So even if you're a math genius, this is a very, very repeatable, predictable thing that happens. I give you that experience. Obviously it's a bit artificial, but I just wanted to give you a quick experience of what TOMO can do. Imagine that, but magnified across organisations. Imagine you have a low TOMO leader that puts you under a lot of pressure. Imagine the impact that that could have on your performance. Equally, imagine an organisation that's designed to maximise play versus potential. Again, you might imagine quite a different set of outcomes, and that's what we see predictably in the data. So, what we were seeing there in you was what we call a distraction effect. When you have high TOMO, you have high ability to do tactical and adaptive performance. As you start to decrease your TOMO, you're still tactically there. You are still trying to solve the puzzle. I did this with a hedge fund about 2 weeks ago. Everyone was kind of PhD in math, and they exploded as they were trying to solve it, and a lot of them couldn't actually do it. Some of them just sat down and gave up on the side, which is quite funny. I won't name the hedge fund. You're still trying, but you start to get distracted. Panic, oh my god, everyone's going to judge me. You start thinking about the context instead of the problem. It affects your ability to problem solve. If we reduce TOMO even further, we get something that is called the cancellation effect. Cancellation effect is when you're checking the boxes. You're doing your tactical performance, but you're actually low in your ability to be adaptive. This explains why, if you have a team member, either now or in the past, where you look at and you go, they're just turning up and taking the paycheck, they don't care. They're still doing enough to keep their job, but they're not doing anything extra. It's because they aren't enjoying the work, they don't feel like they're making a difference, they don't feel like they're learning and progressing. Low play purpose and potential. It's entirely predictable based upon this research. There's something even worse that can happen though, and this we call the Cobra effect. The Cobra effect, I'm gonna tell you a story to bring this to life. This is another story set in the early 1800s. It's set in the city in India of Delhi. In the early 1800s, the British government were running that city, and there was an epidemic of snakes. So cobra running around, not actually running around, slithering around, until we don't have many snakes like this in England, slithering around everywhere, and the British government were like, we need to get rid of these snakes. So what they did is they put a bounty scheme into effect. They said, if you bring us in a dead cobra, we will give you a financial reward. I thought this made a lot of sense. So dead cobras started coming in by the bucket load. Loads and loads of cobras, everyone was pleased. Wow, what a roaring success, they said. Until they discovered that locals had created cobra farms. Or basically breeding cobras, killing them, and then bringing them in for the bounty. So the British said, oh, we can't have that. They shut down the bounty scheme. True historical story. The locals who created the cobra farms couldn't even be bothered to kill the snakes, so they released them into the streets, and the snake population doubled as a result of this scheme. I share that story because an equivalent thing happens in business when you lower TOMO that far. What you get is people cheating the system. They're still hitting their numbers, they're still hitting their objectives, but they've lost the ability or care to be adaptive, and they've gone even further and become maladaptive. If you look at Wells Fargo, if you look at United, any Australians in the room? No, if you look at the Australian cricket team, right now, high maladaptive behavior, and I bet you, if you look at those organizations, Wells Fargo, United, potentially the Aussies, you'll probably see an environment where I bet you there's a lot of pressure, a lot of economic pressure, a lot of emotional pressure, leaders not leading in the right way, all those kind of things. Now this framework feels simple when you build up to it, but the reality is that most leaders don't understand this. Most leaders only understand tactical performance and don't understand TOMO. And therefore, when things are difficult or you need to improve performance, you double down on tactical strategies. As a result of that, you lower TOMO, and you create pressure in the system that creates predictable effects like you see in Wells Fargo. Once you understand that tactical and adaptive performance are important, and once you understand the concept of TOMO, you start to have a much, much better palette for how to unlock performance and actually get people to do things in the right way. And just to bring this to life with one story, this is playing out in public education in the US right now. So in pursuit of performance in public education, the people who are running it are bringing so-called business best practices into education and effectively doubling down on tactical strategies. Scripting, league tables, ranking, all these kind of things. Sounds good, sounds like a great way of unlocking performance if you only understand tactical performance and not TOMO. But if you understand those, then you'll realize that that's creating low TOMO environment for teachers, and that would allow you to predict distraction effects, cancellation effects, and COBRA effects. That's what you see. A lot of stress, teachers reporting a huge increase in stress, distracting them from the job at hand. You see cancellation effects. I know that my kids might need a different way of teaching, but they've got to hit these, they've got to do these exams, they've got to learn this syllabus, so I'm just going to teach the test. And then you see cheating scandals, COBRA effects. This was from the Atlanta cheating scandal, where hundreds of teachers were shown to be actually correcting incorrect answers from their kids. It wasn't just one teacher, it was hundreds of teachers. It was systematic. Now, that doesn't mean that Ms. Parks is a bad person. It really doesn't. What it means is that you've created a system that created predictable issues. So it's not their fault, it's the conditions that they're in. So that's kind of the second thing we wanted to talk about, what really drives performance, and our answer is total motivation. The final thing is, what is culture? Like, how do you create the conditions to maximize culture and avoid these kind of things? So the way that we measure TOMO is we add up the play, purpose, and potential, we subtract the indirect motives, the emotional pressure, economic pressure, and inertia. You can see they're weighted according to the proximity to the work. So play is squarely around the work, we found it to be the most powerful motivator. Inertia is the furthest away, it's the most destructive. We measure on a 7-point Likert scale, it gives you a score between negative 100 and positive 100, love net promoter score. So I'm going to show to you how this number predicts performance with some simple adaptive performance outcomes. I want you to tell me what you think is the lowest TOMO airline.
United.
Spirit. We always get some venom in this one.
Frontier.
This is small data, we haven't got everyone in our data set. United, we say, like, what about the highest TOMO element?
Delta.
Southwest, Delta maybe. What's that? JetBlue, perhaps? So this is what we look like, United. By the way, this was done 2 years ago, before the United issues that you're seeing right now. United in a world of pain right now as a result of a low TOMO environment. We see American, we see Delta, we see Southwest at the top, entirely predictable. What you can't see, just because of this slide, is that is a straight line relationship between TOMO in this example, a customer service outcome, which is one measure of adaptive performance. Now, based on this, you would have said at the beginning, United are going to have a problem. If you look at United right now, I don't know if you've heard this, you saw the story where somebody was hauled off the plane, manhandled, it was caught on YouTube. What happened there was somebody was under such pressure to get that plane off the tarmac that they forgot what the right thing to do was be. If you look at United, they just killed a pet. Did anybody see this? The awful story. That person is not a bad person, but they're under such pressure, they don't care about what's right or wrong because they're doing what it says in the book. There are many other examples at the moment. Equally, when you go on a Southwest plane, planes are pretty much the same. We like this industry because it's a commodity. Basically, a plane is pretty similar to a plane. What makes the difference is the experience you get. When you go on Southwest, you feel their TOMO. You feel their play, purpose, and potential. Let's look at another one. Grocers. Anybody get the lowest, so where you buy your food and that kind of thing? Lowest TOMO grocer? Is that?
Walmart.
Maybe. Highest TOMO grocer? Whole Foods. Trader Joe's. Albertsons, Safeway, Walgreens, Trader Joe's is the top one. What's interesting, again, fairly commoditized business. You could argue this is slightly less. Actually, if you were to look at the relationship, it's slightly broader, actually, in terms of variance. But you feel this when you walk in. Here's the interesting thing about this one, I think. So this was done before Whole Foods was bought by Amazon. If you look at the press since they've been bought by Amazon, you can can see all sorts of issues happening at Whole Foods. You see supply issues happening. You see a lot of stress. You see employees reporting crying at work because they're under increased pressure. So our prediction is that based upon this, that Amazon are going to double down the tactical strategy, they're going to decrease the time out, Whole Foods performance is going to go down. We can kind of see that playing out right now. Last one. I think we've got one more. Yeah, okay. Thought this would be fun. Lowest Tomo bank?
Wells Fargo.
Yes. Highest Tomo bank?
City.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Credit Suisse. Okay. Highest one, US bank. Is anybody from US bank here? No. Could have given you a little clap. Chase, Bank of America, Wells Fargo. Wells Fargo is the lowest Tomo bank on the data set. This was done before the cheating scandal that everybody pretty much knows. Does anybody know about that story? Yeah, horrible. But again, entirely predictable. So, I'm not going to go through this story in any detail, kind of you all know it, but this is a predictable story. You see distraction effects, stressful, you get people just focusing on cross-selling, that's all they're doing in the branches, and then this was some kind of cobra effects that were happening. One of my favourite or least favourite examples of this was in Wells Fargo branches, there were hourly conference calls where you had to report how many new accounts you had opened, and you were named and shamed if you were the bottom of the list. So inevitably, that's going to create cobra effects. So the final part of this is, how does this relate to culture? How do you actually create, or avoid, rather, a Wells Fargo or a United? How do you create Trader Joe's or Southwest? It's all about culture. Now, I've worked for years and years in the culture space, and what I've realized is that a lot of people think that culture is vision and values and the behaviors of an organization. It's the thing you put on the wall, it's the feel good, rah, rah, yeah, this, here's what we stand for. That is important, but actually to truly unlock Tomo at a deep level, to really unlock performance, you've actually got to think of culture much more broadly as the entire operating model of an organization, and that's what we do. Effectively, it's anything that motivates people is the forces. A lot of organizations we work with, like the lowest Tomo ones, have a set of motivators that look a bit like this. We use a magnet analogy. Imagine you're an iron ball in an organization. Everything about how it's set up is a magnet attracting you in a different direction. Your talent system, your org structure, your leader, the training you've just been on all points you in different directions. And if they're poorly designed and poorly aligned, it's very confusing. And you end up following the thing that's most recent or the thing that's loudest, perhaps wrongly. The best organizations, of course, are the ones that are lined up their motivators towards Tomo and in the same direction. That's why if you have salespeople, for example, I'm working with a company right now, there's a high growth startup in the tech space, and they are trying to open up different geographies with little cross-functional teams, and they're wondering why their salespeople are disengaged. Well, it's because their incentives are not lined up with the communities they're working in. Simple magnet alignment issue. So what are these magnets? In the research that we've done, we've identified a set of these, and I'm going to give you them in order. The potential swing in Tomo is at the top. So basically, if you do it poorly, here's how much you can kill Tomo. If you do it well, here's how much you can boost it. I used to think leadership would be number one. It's not. The number one thing is structure and role design. How you set up your organization, how you design teams, and most importantly, how you frame roles for people is the most important. If you look back on your career and you think there was a job that you were in that you didn't do well in, it's probably because it didn't drive your own play, purpose, and potential. So the best leaders are the ones that frame and craft roles around people's Tomo. That's a huge swing in Tomo. Second is talent and performance management. This is about how you set up your talent system, how you set up performance management. A low Tomo version of a performance management is a Game of Thrones type scenario, where basically you've got a pyramid scheme of talent. You've got peers competing with each other to go up to the next level, and to get promoted, you kind of have to disappear your boss for that slot to open up. It creates competition, creates pressure, it doesn't create lots of sharing of information. I come from a consulting background, that was the model. It created very little sharing of information and collaboration. A high Tomo is lots of different career ladders, lots of different ways for people to learn, for people to progress. Then we've got team behaviors and routines, how teams work. Do you operate in an agile way where teams are actually collaborating, sharing information, load balancing themselves? Or do you work as individual contributors or in silos where work just gets passed over to other groups? Can you own your whole performance cycle? Next is decision making. Is decision making something that happens just at a certain level, or it's not clear what the path the decisions are, or actually is that transparent and two-way? Purpose and identity is all about, are you clear on what you stand for, your vision and your values? Planning and goal setting, is your strategy set top-down once a year, or is it set top-down and bottom-up, and is that iterated by teams? And then finally, leadership behavior. This is how leaders turn up and actually what they do, and actually do they really live and breathe TOMO, or do they just talk a good game? All of these things can be designed to kill TOMO and designed to optimize, to boost TOMO. And the work that we do is help organizations figure out which of these are broken and how to point them all in the same direction. And the last thing I'll share, and then we can get into some questions, is we often get asked, like, this is great, but how do you implement this? What does this actually mean? The way we approach this is sometimes organizations have a magnet issue. So some companies come to us and say, we need to create a great culture. We don't actually know what that looks like. We haven't defined it. So that would be work in this magnet, personal identity. Some organizations come to us and say, our teams aren't really owning their own agenda and owning their own work. We're therefore having to micromanage them. Therefore, it's all about how do you get them people to set plans and get them to behave in the right way. Some organizations say we have a very toxic performance management system. How can you help with that? So sometimes it's magnet by magnet. But what we're increasingly finding is that the way to transform a whole organization is by what we call an atomic model of transformation. Basically, what we've done is break this system down into kind of 12 skills or habits that we think everybody can find value in that are high TOMO. And what we do is monthly sessions for entire verticals. Typically, when you run training programs, you look at horizontals. Instead, we look at full verticals combined with a reinforcement program. And to give you a sense of the kind of skills and habits that are important, once we build the foundations, we talk about team ownership. How can you make sure that every team is clear on who their customer is, what problem they're solving for that customer? How can you make sure each team have quarterly goals and plans around them? How can you make sure that teams are load balancing and sharing information? How can you make sure that teams are able to objectively retrospective on performance? Then we talk about learning, which obviously is relevant particularly for this group. How do you make sure that individuals are owning their own skills development, that they're actually pulling coaching from other people, that the standards are high for skills, and most interestingly, how do you create skills-based compensation models? One of the pieces of technology that we're building is an alternative to performance-based compensation. Most people, okay, you've hit these business results, therefore we're going to give you a bonus or promotion or not. What we're trying to do is change that to create an algorithm that computes your skill points and pays you as you develop skills, which we find a much higher TOMO solution. We can take trade group about that. Then we talk about collaboration. How can you do role and team design? How can you do expansive ideation? How do you iterate and align with leaders and experts? And then we put it all together. So all that to say, that to actually activate this, of course you can do projects around culture, but you can also train large groups of people around the skills and habits that really unlock TOMO in teams and individuals and organizations. So that's basically what I wanted to share. I know it's a quick burst through. Do you guys have questions? Any questions on anything I've talked about? Yeah?
Can you tell us more about the skill-based compensation?